Good morning. Welcome to Victory Fellowship Church. We are the little church with a big heart. We're doing great big things for God. And every time we touch a soul, what is it?
It's a great big thing for God.
All right. God bless y'all. You may be seated. Amen. Hey, Terry. Glory to God. Amen. God is good. God is good. Well, we want to get you started off with a couple good Christmas jokes this morning. Here's the question. What kind of Christmas music do elves like? Think about this 1 minute. What kind of Christmas music do elves like? Rap music. All right. Here's one more for you, just in case you didn't like that one. Okay. What do snowmen call their offspring? What do snowmen call their offspring?
Snowballs.
They call them children. Amen. All right. Take your Bibles, turn to Luke chapter 2. Christmas is fast approaching. Remember, he's the reason for the season. As you well know, in my secular business, I work in the Walmarts. That Monday's my last day there, but just in the last day or two, I've started saying Merry Christmas to most people that walk by. And I always take note of people. They really love to hear you say Merry Christmas to them. I think they hear it so rarely. Some of them will actually kind of stop and say, Merry Christmas. Yeah, I mean, it really, it's funny, but in America, Merry Christmas ought to be a very common thing this type of year, but I think people are still afraid to say anything that would offend anybody else. But let me tell you something, we need to be bold about Jesus, and part of it is go ahead and say Merry Christmas, amen? And people will be surprised in a good way most of the time. They'll be surprised in a good way. But Luke chapter 2, starting at verse 8, if you'll turn with me there and give me an amen when you get there. I'm going to talk about the shepherds. And yes, amen, amen. Amen, praise the Lord. All right, I'm assuming everyone's there. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. Flock is a group of sheep. It's also a group of birds, but in this case, it's sheep. Watching over the flock of sheep by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were very afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be for all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find the baby wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. And it came to pass, as the angels were gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said one to another, Let us now go down to Bethlehem and see this thing which has come to pass, which the Lord has made known unto us. And they came with haste, and they found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. And when they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning this child, of course, that he was the Savior of the world. And all they that heard it wondered at those things. The NIV says they were amazed at these things. All that heard it wondered at those things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. The NIV says she treasured them in her heart. Thank you, Father, for your word. And thank you for coming to this earth and sharing this good news through the angel to the shepherds. The good news was proclaimed to shepherds, and I really love the fact that it came to the shepherds. And why were the shepherds chosen? Well, there were probably a lot of reasons why the shepherds were chosen, but for one thing, the shepherds were on the lower rung of society. They weren't They weren't high-fluting in any way. They weren't even in the middle rung of society. Well, they were on the low rung of society. So when Jesus came and said, "Unto you is born in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord," he was speaking to the lowliest rung of society. And let me tell you something, people, I've noticed this about people. In my business, I get to meet a lot of different people. And a lot of times, people that don't have near as much are happier, more content people. They're also more humble people, generally speaking. They just are, you know, people that have a lot tend to be proud and arrogant and think that they did it all themselves when they couldn't even take a breath without God. So people that God shares the news with are those that tend to be more humble and receptive and open to the things of God. And generally speaking, unfortunately, that tends to be the poorer ones in society. So that may be another reason why the shepherds were chosen. God needed a group of people that when they saw the birth of Jesus would be excited about it and go spread it abroad. Amen? And he knew he had that kind of people in the shepherds. The other thing is, we can't overlook is, why did he choose the shepherds? It's symbolism too. Jesus himself called himself the good shepherd. He's the one that shepherds us and takes care of us. Isaiah chapter 53 verse 6 says this, when we're compared to sheep so many times in the Bible, but in Isaiah it says, "All we like sheep have gone astray. We've turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all." And then in Psalms 95, it says, "He is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, and we are the sheep of his hand." So the symbolism here as to why, one of the reasons God may have chosen shepherds, because he's the great shepherd. We are the sheep. He was coming to earth to shepherd his sheep, to grow up and to die and offer us salvation and offer us a relationship with him. And of course, we know the 23rd Psalm, you know, and as we mentioned earlier today, David was a shepherd. Glory, amen. You know, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. How many have experienced the Lord as your shepherd, taking care of you, leading you in the paths of righteousness, leading you beside the still waters, which is peace, preparing a table before you, even the presence of your enemies? So there's symbolism here as to why the shepherds were chosen. And the message was delivered supernaturally, wasn't it? It was delivered by an angel that the Bible says came upon them, and it was at night. How many have ever been way out in the country at night and you look up at the stars and they're absolutely brilliant because they aren't being interfered with the lights of the city at all? This is the way I picture it that night. Of course, back then they didn't have electricity. They didn't have electric lights, so the lights of the city wouldn't have disturbed anyway. But on that night, I believe they looked up and the stars shone brightly. It's an amazing, such a difference when you get out in the country, away from the lights of the city, and you look up, the sky is so brilliant. But on this brilliant night, there was something more than just the stars. It was the angel of the Lord came upon them. "And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them." And I've never seen or experienced seeing the glory of the Lord. How many have felt the glory of the Lord? You felt the presence of God. You felt the power of God. I have too. But they saw it had to be a brilliant light coming, emanating from this angel. And the glory of the Lord shone around about them. And of course, they were very afraid. It's not like this kind of thing happened every day, right? So, but God visited them in a very supernatural way. You know, when God comes to you, if you remember when you were first saved, it may not have been with an outward angel coming and speaking to you, but it was a supernatural thing, because when you get saved, it's the power of God that does that. Jesus said, "No man comes unto me except the Father draw him." So it's the Father that draws you to come to Jesus and be saved. That's why little ones, when they're even 4, 5, 6 years old, if they want to get saved, who are we to tell them they can't receive the Lord? Because the Spirit of the Lord can draw a little child. They may not understand everything the way you do, but they understand the drawing and the presence of God, and they sense the power and presence of God. I think even babies in the womb can sense the power and presence of God. We know they can, because Elizabeth, when she was carrying John, do you remember what happened? The Bible says that John leaped in Elizabeth's womb when Mary walked in who was carrying Jesus. So even in the womb, we can sense the power and presence of God. But this was a supernatural experience that happened, and they were very afraid. And the message in verse 10, the angel said, "Behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to who? Which shall be to all people." Now, I don't know about you, but when I think about this being done in a play, I think of the angel being kind of stilted and saying, you know, "And behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people." Kind of dry and stilted. I believe with all my heart this angel had enthusiasm and excitement in his voice, and he was anything but stilted. You see, heaven itself, with all the angels, had waited hundreds of years for the arrival of Jesus Christ to come on the scene. So I believe that when this angel communicated it, it was with joy and enthusiasm. I'm not saying it was over-the-top giddy, but I'm saying it wasn't stilted at all. And it was, "Behold, I bring you great news of great joy, which is for all people." Glory to God. Not just for the privileged, for all people. Not just for the poor. You know, in this day in society, it seems like the poor in some ways are able to get more benefits than the middle-income people. So this great news is for all people. The rich, the poor, the smart, the simple, the blacks, the whites, the Floridians, the Michiganders, right? Amen. Pray for the Michiganders in the winter, right? So, but God loves all people, and I'm so glad. And he died for each one of us, and he values every soul equal to the other, no matter what their status in life, no matter what their handicaps, no matter what their abilities. God loves you, and he values you. So I'm so glad that the angel said that... "Behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people." But then he comes back. Look at this. He comes back after saying to all people. Then he brings it back down to exactly where the shepherds were. And he makes it personal. He says, yes, the angel says it's for all people. But then he says, "For unto you is born." He's talking to each one of those shepherds individually, and he's talking to them as a group. He says, "For unto you is born this day in the city of David." My stepdad, he had a head knowledge that Christ died for all the sins of the whole world. But until it became personal, until he received it personally for him, that Jesus died for him, it was just head knowledge. You see, it would be easy, especially for poor people that don't feel like they're worth a lot, to think, well, yeah, he died for all the sins of the whole world. And I guess that includes me, because I guess I was kind of thrown in as a part of the package. That would be the attitude some people will have. But no. Every person is of such great value. That's why I believe the angel said, "For unto you, shepherds," unto you, not just the whole world, not just everybody else, but unto you personally, a Savior has been born, which is Christ the Lord. And God is so personal with his people. Those of us that have children and grandchildren, we have an individual relationship with each one of those children. My grandkids are on the front row, and I love them each equally, and I love and enjoy each one, my relationship I have with each one in a special way. God is that much way. I mean, God's the same way. He enjoys that. He seeks out a relationship and time with Michelle. He seeks out a relationship and time with David. And you all, you know, and every one of us, nobody else can replace what you can give Jesus, which is your time and your fellowship with him and returning your love to him. Isn't it wonderful that we can put a smile on God's face and that he's such a personal God? Isn't he such a personal God? There was a song It came out several years ago, and I kind of liked the song. It was kind of a catchy tune. I think the singer was Bette Midler. I mean, if I'm saying that right. But anyway, the name of the song was "From a Distance," and I guess maybe it had a point that God can see things from a distance, and maybe from a distance things don't look so bad. But the point is, God doesn't love us from a distance. He came in really close to us, and He wants to touch our lives. He wants to move in our lives. He wants that personal relationship with each one of us. So, the angel of the Lord says to the shepherds this, "And this shall be a sign to you." This is for you. You're going to be part of God's plan today. "This shall be a sign for you. You shall find a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger." That this is where Jesus is. This will be a sign. You need to go seek Him out and find Him. And as soon as the angel said that, it was like there was an exclamation mark put on what the angel said. Because as soon as the angel said, "This will be a sign to you, you shall find a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger," suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men." Can you imagine? They're already amazed at one angel, but now the heavenly host just shouts out and rings out this praise. I kind of imagine they were kind of all on their knees, or maybe even on their face on the ground as all this was happening. Says, what a demonstration of God's power. And like I said, the angels had waited hundreds of years for this to happen, and they're absolutely thrilled. "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men." And I believe they sang it, they did it in unison. It's such have you ever been around when the shuttle went off and it shook the ground? I believe when that heavenly host showed up and they said that, it was a shaking. There was so much power and volume in their voices that it was just a remarkable experience. Wouldn't you have enjoyed being there? Yeah. Amen. Now, you would have been scared at first like they were, but you would have walked away like, wow, you know, what an amazing, amazing thing. Amen. All right. "This shall be a sign to you." And suddenly, you know, God puts that exclamation mark on it, you know, with all the angels, the heavenly host. "And it came to pass," verse 15, "it came to pass as the angels were gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said one to another, 'Let us now go even unto Bethlehem and see this thing which has come to pass, which the Lord has made known to us.'" Obviously, the shepherds were chosen because they would receive the word and be excited about it. They would go and see what had happened, and then we're going to find out that they went abroad sharing it with everybody. Amen. There's a reason why God chose you. Did you know you're chosen? Yeah, in Ephesians it says we are chosen. You know, we are chosen. We are set apart. God chose us before the foundation of the world, Ephesians says. There's another place Paul wrote, "Ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation." And you've been chosen, number one, because God loves you and wants that relationship with you. But you've also been chosen to spread the good news and spread the gospel and talk to other people about Jesus. Yes. Saints, people's hearts, many times at Christmas, are more open to God than at any other time. Be sensitive. You may think, well, everybody's heard the gospel. They may have heard it up here, but have they been touched by it here in their heart? Amen. Do they really know Jesus died for them personally? Right. Be sensitive, because you are God's tool. Amen. Isn't it neat how God came to earth? Jesus was God in the flesh. Isn't it neat how God came to earth in such a gentle, non-assuming way? I mean, if anyone deserved to come like royalty with great demonstration, it was Him. He was the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. But He came in such a gentle, non-assuming way. He came in a way that He was letting people know that He was approachable. Amen? He was approachable. But he was the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And of course, you all know that there was no room for them in the inn. Amen? So God came in a very humble way. But He came to let us know that we can approach Him no matter who we are. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. And they went to see Jesus. They went to see Him. They went to see what was going on with the baby. They went with unity. They said, let us go. Let us go. At husbands and wives, how hard is it sometimes to get two people to agree on anything, right? Am I right? But the shepherds were in agreement on this. See, God brings people together in unity. By the way, God looks at individual groups of people. He said to the shepherds, unto you a child is born. He knows Victory Fellowship Church here. He knows every individual church. And he looks at that as an individual group of people. But he also looks at each one of us as individuals. Isn't it a blessing? So, unto us a child is born. And they said, let us go. Let us go in unity to see this great thing that God has done. And they went with haste. They were excited about what they had heard, that the Savior was born. So they didn't dilly-dally. I mean, we should never dilly-dally when God asks us to do something and tells us to do something. And we ought to do it with some fervor and excitement because God is still at work saving people. Can you say amen? Amen. He really is. Amen. All right, so they went, okay, and they went with haste. And when they saw it, what's it say? And when they saw it, they made known abroad the saying which was told to them about Christ, that he was the Savior of the world. And of course, when they shared that good news, people were amazed. You know, and there's people out there. You may think, like I said, you may think everyone's heard about salvation, but some of them, it's never really registered the great salvation. And be open to sharing the gospel. It's not complicated. Jesus loves you so much. He died on the cross for your sins. And he's alive now forevermore. And he wants a relationship with you. You don't have to put it in those kind of words. Put them in your own words. But it's so easy and so simple, isn't it? Amen. Amen. Can we give God praise this morning? Yes. Hallelujah. So, I'm going to read this again. And when they saw it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning this child. And all they that heard the shepherds talk about it wondered at those things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things. The NIV says Mary treasured these things in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen as it was told to them. Mary, when you have things that happen in your life that are obviously very, they're God moving in your life. Yes. You ought to keep those things in your heart. You ought to treasure those things. Amen. Yes. Obviously, in God's time and God's way, you share those things too. But I like what the NIV says, treasure those things. How many treasure in your heart the things that God has done for you? Amen. Amen. And the Bible says the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God. They went back to work being shepherds. God's got his people in every profession. But I guarantee you from this point on as being shepherds, they were a different people. And they talked to people about the Savior. They had an excitement to them because they weren't just shepherding sheep. They were helping the Lord shepherd people. Question for you today. Has your Christian walk with God been a little dry? Do you need to get some sense of excitement and awe and wonder back in your life about God? Start sharing like the shepherds did about this great salvation. Amen. And watch what God can do. Amen? You have an opportunity, the Spirit of God through you, as you share the gospel, you have the opportunity to see God work through you so you can begin to get more of a sense of excitement and awe and wonder about God as you allow God to use you. Again, many people have never heard the gospel in a personal way. They know maybe facts, but until they open their heart and receive Jesus, they'll never experience what you have. The Bible says we have this treasure in earthen vessels. Jesus is our treasure in earthen vessels. But he doesn't want you to just keep it all in, right? He wants you to share it. And there's a right way and a right time. But don't be, Paul said this, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it's the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes. And the Bible talks about, you know, how shall they believe unless they hear? And how shall they hear unless a preacher is sent? Well, y'all are preachers, amen. Let the word of God be sent. Amen. I want to pray with you today. You may be watching today and you might not know Jesus. You may know that, you may have a head knowledge that he died on the cross for you, but you don't have a relationship with him. You don't know for sure that you're going to heaven. And God wants you to know for sure. The Bible says these things are written that you may know you have eternal life. So God wants you to know for sure. So I'd like you to pray this prayer with me. If you have a hunger, if God's drawing you to receive Jesus, if you want to know for sure you're going to heaven, then all you have to do is open your heart, be willing to do whatever God asks you to do. Man, repent of any lifestyle of sin. Just say, God, help me to stop the bad things I'm doing and help me to come to you. But most of all, receive his forgiveness because he died on the cross as payment for your sins to completely forgive you, to completely cleanse you as well. So if you have not received the Lord and you feel God drawing you, pray this prayer with me right now. Dear Lord Jesus, thank you so much for dying on the cross for all my sins. Wash me clean by your Spirit. Come into my heart and help me to live for you. Help me to love you back. And help me to tell others about you. And how you have saved me. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Give the Lord a clap offering. God's good. God's good. I want to say a quick prayer for the Christians that are watching today. Father, in the name of Jesus, help us, Lord. Father, if we've gotten a little bit dry, if we've lost our sense of awe and wonder, help us to remember how awesome and wonderful you are and to share that goodness with others. Help us not to succumb to a spirit of fear where we're afraid of being rejected or anything like that, but help us to have that joy and excitement about our lives and that, God, that we can make an eternal difference in the lives of people. Thank you, God, for doing it. In the name of Jesus, amen. Well, remain with us here on Facebook. We got some good music coming up. And God bless you as we worship the Lord. Amen. Amen. God's so good to us.
Amen.
Hallelujah. You get to have a relationship with the Lord in this life, and then you get to go to heaven and have a relationship with him there as well.
That's right.
And we're on this journey together. This world is not our home. We're passing through.
That's right.
Glory. Yeah.
Alone and I needed a hand. I was going down, but someone ran. We will have it on the display up here, too, for those that are here with us in the service. God bless you. Angels, we have heard on high. Praise God. And just as Pastor was speaking, what a glorious day.
Angels, we have heard on high, sweetly singing all the plains, and the mountains in reply.
Thank you. Yes, amen. Thank you, Solara. So awesome. Mary, did you know? Amazing thing that that God sent himself as a little baby. And Mary, can you imagine the awesome responsibility that she had? Yet God helped her in that responsibility to raise up the one that would become the Savior of all mankind. Mary, did you know when you kissed your baby boy, you kissed the face of God? So amazing. Well, I want to say a big thank you for those that joined us today on Facebook. The fact that you're here with us is very special to
us. Personally, very special to not only us, but each one of you are very, very special to God. And as this Christmas season happens and as Christmas draws near, remember how much God loves you and remember that He's the reason for the season. We want to welcome you. If you live close by in the Bartow area, and even if you don't, to come by and see us at 530 West Hooker Street. If you want to support us financially, you can do that by sending a check or money order to P.O. Box 134, of course, Victory Fellowship Church. That's in Bartow, 33831. God bless you. Thank you for being with us. Have a great rest of your day. Amen. Amen.